Our project for today is this holiday memories book, constructed from chipboard and embellished with Tim Holtz's audiology papers, Woodland's tree, and trinkets. It's simple to create and makes a lovely gift. Creating this book begins with the chipboard covers, and we do literally begin with chipboard. I have two pieces that have been cut to 6x9, and if you look closely, you can see where the edges look a little lighter. That's because I took a piece of sandpaper and I just sanded them to remove any sharp edges from cutting. Once that's ready to go, what you're going to do, and I'm using the Scotch Quick Dry Adhesive, it works well for this, and it's a glue that I tend to get myself in less trouble with. What you're going to do is put some out on your work table. There we go, get the lid off. And you're going to mix it with water. You need to thin this out, probably less than 50-50, anything more than that, and you're going to end up with way too much water in your glue, and it's going to not work quite as well. So I'm going to put some out, whoops, well that was probably more than I needed, but nevertheless, I'm going to put some out here, and you can see that I'm definitely watering it down. I'm going to grab a brush, and before I start applying the glue to this chipboard, this is a piece of ordinary white tissue paper. I've crumpled it, and then what I'm going to do is open it up, and I'm going to use all of that texture to my advantage once I lay this out on the cover. It's going to end up, well, I'll show you in one second what it's going to end up looking like, but I'm not going to smooth this out. I don't want this flat. I'm trying to gain some of that texture. So I'm just going to use a brush, and I'm going to brush mix this water and the glue together here on my nonstick craft sheet. And I'm going to quickly just go ahead and apply it to the chipboard. Now you're going to get a certain amount of this that's going to soak right into the chipboard. That's perfectly natural. It's what happens all the time. You just want to make certain that you've applied enough so that it doesn't sink in and dry before you go ahead and get your tissue paper adhered. And you can tell once it's started to sink in too much because it starts to look more like this and less like the parts with the glue all over it. So again, I'm pretty satisfied with the way that this looks. I've got a nice even coat of glue, nothing's drying on me. And then what I'm going to do, well, the first thing I want to do is grab a piece of paper towel and just clean this up a little bit. Alright, so now that I've got that ready, I'm going to just take the tissue paper, lay it over the top, and I don't want giant wrinkles in here, but I don't mind the small ones because really that's what I'm aiming for. You're just going to press that in place. If you get an air bubble, just grab a pin or something with a little pointy tip on it and push it in the air bubble and then just smooth it out. You can do one of two things. You can either let this dry like this or you can trim it now. It doesn't make any difference. Ultimately, you'll have to trim that to some degree, and I'll show you that in one second. So I'm going to put this to one side and let me just grab my bottle of glue and put this back inside. There's really no need to waste that. And most of this is untouched with from the water anyway. And the little bit of water that's in there is not going to affect the stability of the glue. Alright, so I'm going to wipe most of this off and I'm going to put it, I have a cup with water to one side that you can't see, but obviously I don't want the glue to ruin that brush. So let me grab some more paper towel. Just clean this up so that I'm not working in a sticky mess. Okay. So let me put the lid back on. Once you get that applied and the glue dries, it's going to look like this. Now you can trim this with scissors, you can trim this with a rotary cutter. If you want very uneven, more rough edges on your book covers, you can trim it like this and you get this hanging on. It's, again, it's entirely subjective, whatever you like. If you want to trim it with scissors, it's pretty straightforward. You're just going to turn, use the chipboard as a cutting guide, and you can do a little bit better job than I just did. With mine, I actually did it with the rotary cutter. It really is my cutting tool of choice. But once you get this done, you're going to bring in some of this, I like this Martha Stewart satin finish paint. This is called Wedding Cake White. Once you get this trimmed, you're going to put a coat of Wedding Cake White paint on it. Once that's dry, the next thing I want to do is add some color to the edge, and I'm going to use Distress Ink for that. I want this to look a little bit aged, and to achieve that, I'm going to use a combination of antique linen and walnut stain. Now, you can do this with your fingers, you can do this with a piece of cotton dry foam, and in fact, you could use just one color. You don't have to do both like I'm about to, but you can if you want, just depending on how much discoloration you want, how much age you're trying to achieve. So I'm starting with some antique linen. This is a piece of cut and dry foam. You can see that I've got walnut stain on the other side, and I'm just scooching it on here. I find I get far more random looks if I don't make any effort at all to think about how I'm putting this on. The more I overthink it, the worse it gets. So once you get this on, then it's just a question of bringing in the walnut stain. Now this is a much darker color, so I'm going to go far lighter with this, and you can see immediately how dark that color is. You can use a lot, you can use a little, it really depends on what you're trying to achieve. And then you can come back and you can kind of blend with your fingers. This is very haphazard. All I'm trying to do is simulate a little bit of age. You know that paper yellows as it ages if it's not acid-free, and of course papers from probably any more than 10 or 12 years ago are generally not acid-free, so this would be very common to see this kind of aging. You need to do this to two. We're going to do the front and the back covers the same way. Once you have this done, we'll start talking about adding that piece of paper to the front and the back cover, and I'll show you how to trim that bottle brush so it'll lie nice and flat on one of your covers. For this book, I'm using papers from Tim's Paper Stash, the Merriment Collection. It has all these wonderful red and white with some beige and black in here. All of these great papers that you can see. This is the cover from the package. I'm using this striped paper for my page background, and then I'm going to use some of these trading stamps, and I'm going to show you that in 1 second. So here is my finished cover. It's been aged, everything is all ready to go, and I've cut my paper. And I like the idea of having a nice wide border around here. It helps show this texture that's in the tissue paper, and of course you can see the distress that we put on there too. Now I'm choosing not to distress the edges of this paper, though you certainly could do that too. It's just a matter of preference. I'm cutting this to 5 1/4 by 8 1/4. That's leaving me with this nice wide border. So let me show you sort of where I am with my cover and about where I'm ready to be. Here's my paper, it's cut. Here is the bottle brush tree. I'm going to put, this is from Tim's Trim Collection, the cream and red. I'm going to put this along here. Here's the little trading cards I alluded to a moment ago. I'm using these stars, the mini numerals, and some other things. I'll show you those eventually, but what I want to do right now is talk about this bottle brush. So let me move this out of the way. This is the second group of bottle brush trees that Tim released, and this one is actually called Woodlands, which is the name of the group of trees, but this is Tree Lot because it has these five, all of the same size trees. The original set had a tree like this, a smaller version about this tall, and a little wreath. For my purposes, I don't need those two other pieces, so this is what made the most sense for me. So what I'm going to do, this is the tree as they come from the package. You can see that this is pretty squished. Now you can fix this by rearranging it. This is all wired into this center spine that's a piece of metal, so this all bends if you want to bend it. If yours get really smushed like this, one of the things that I have found, and this was because I was rinsing color off, I didn't like the way it came out, take this to the sink and run it under some warm water. It will loosen everything up for you, and you'll be able to shape it. You'll have to let it dry, but you'll be able to shape it into something a lot more pleasing than this. So for the sake of argument here, I'm just going to kind of pull this out so I can show you what I did to in order to get this tree ready to go. When you look at these, if you kind of look down from the top and along the edge, occasionally you'll see pieces sticking out where this little brush-like material is longer, and I like to trim those off just so that the tree forms a reasonably nice cone shape. Then the next thing that you have to do, in order to get this tree to lay reasonably flat on your page, and I'm actually going to have to trim this and push it a little bit more, but what you're going to do is, if I hold this up so that you can see the profile, let's see, this way, you can see that this is actually flat, and it's not because I've squished it, it's because I've cut it. So what you need to do is get a pair of scissors that are sharp enough, where are my scissors, that are sharp enough to handle cutting the bulk off of this. And again, let's imagine this tree is nicely shaped, it's not all squished from being in the package. So let me just sort of get this going here. What you're going to do is pick a side, and it really doesn't make any difference. And you're going to, this needs to be stood up, going to come in with the scissors, and you're going to trim like this until you have flattened the back of this tree so that it will lay nicely against the front of your book cover. Now, as you get toward the top here, once you lay this on the page and it's like this, this isn't going to be tight against the cover, this end here, so you don't have to worry too much about trimming up at the top, but you do need to trim this off in the back. And ideally, you can trim it so that the back of this is kind of parallel to the bottom of your tree, so that you know that, the bottom of your trunk. So you know if this little trunk is against the card, the back of this tree is against it too, and it will lay nice and flat for you. That's really your goal. So let me just clear this out of the way. Once you've got your tree, now you can see that I have colored the bottom of this trunk. As they come from the package, they're this, you know, unfinished white color. All I did was take, this is the Walnut Stain Distress Ink, and all you do is just ink this up. It acts just like stain. If you had bought stain at a home improvement store or whatever, and you can just go ahead and you can color it. Now, you could wrap this, see how I have this trim piece cut, if I could pick it up, for the bottom of the card. You could wrap this trunk too. It adds a little bit of visual texture and it creates some cohesion because you'll see this twice. But all you have to do, again, if I'm kind of keeping with these natural colors. I was thinking I might do the tree green, but the more I played with it, the more I realized that I really liked sort of this off-white natural and then silver color from the stars. So you're just going to do this to add some color to your trunk. Let me just cover this up and get it out of the way. And then we're going to work with this one because it's set and it's ready to go. And although I can do see one little spot here where this is long, I do like to trim that out. So you've got your back trimmed, you've got your trunk colored, and you have a couple options. I think I'm going to take some of Tim's Clear Rock Candy Distress Glitter. This is not real sparkly, it's not iridescent, but it will refract the light. And I think I'm going to put it on the tree, and it's actually pretty easy to do that. I'm going to use some of this super thick tacky glue. I'm just going to put it on my fingers, and I'm just going to touch it to the edge of the bristles here. And that's going to put enough glue on so that I can get the Clear Rock Candy Glitter to adhere without it actually being a mess. So that's probably too big a chunk. I don't want big blobs of glue because that will result in big blobs of glitter, and I want a little bit more spaced out kind of delicate look. So that looks pretty good. Let me just get the glue off my fingers, and I need to bring in a piece of scratch paper, which I'm not seeing one, so we'll just do this over the top of a piece of paper towel. So all I'm going to do is open my glitter and then just spread it over this tree. Now, obviously there's a ton of glitter that's fallen inside the branches, which I don't want to leave there because it's just going to fall off and get wasted. So I'm going to kind of flick this to get this out. And then what I may do is just go ahead and tap this into the glitter. Now, this is going to be really subtle because there's no color to this glitter. But once the glue dries and it becomes transparent once it dries, then you're not going to see any of that glue, and you're just going to see some really nice subtle sparkle on the end of the tree branches. So I need to put this to one side to let it dry, but if I turn that and the light hits it, I think you can see the reflection of the light off of the glitter. A really nice touch. Let me just sort of get that all in the middle of the paper towel so I don't have a glitter event. As much as I like glitter, I like it contained. So I'm going to put this off to one side. Now I'm going to let my tree dry, and then we can talk about what's going on here. This is from the trading card paper, and these are all 12 by 12 papers. I just cut this down. Now, in order to get this to really stand up and show against this background, I did come in with walnut stain, and I made an effort to kind of age the edges and even a little bit inward from the edges of this. I like the way that this kind of stands off and really shows up now against the background. These are stars. Again, this is from one of Tim's newer collection. They're just called mirrored stars. And there's a bunch of them in here in various sizes. So I'm going to glue those in place. This is just the numbers 25 from his mini numeral set. And this is one of the word bands. It's the Christmas set. The next thing I want to do is show you how I color this. And then really, it's just a question of assembling it all, punching some holes, and then we'll talk about the pages. Turning our attention to the rest of the embellishments on the cover, you can see that I've got things kind of laid out here. I did want to point one more thing out on the tree. I decided to use one of the mirrored stars on the top of the tree. I think it will add some nice cohesion and continuity because the stars will appear on the background and they'll also be here on the tree. So I'm going to put that to one side. I just use the same Aileen Super Thick Tacky Glue. I want to let that finish drying. This is trim from this Ideology set. This is called Trimmings Natural Red and Cream. Here is the rickrack. I'm just going to put a piece of this along the bottom just for a little visual interest. As I mentioned a moment ago, if you want to take some more of this or one of these other ones and wrap it around the trunk of the tree, it makes a nice touch as well. The stars are from this set of mirrored stars, and there's got to be 25 of them in here, and they're a variety of different sizes. I want to say there's 3 or 4 anyway. The word band here is from this set of Christmas word bands, and there's lots of different sentiments on here. From walking in a winter wonderland to jingle bells, the one that I chose says, have yourself a merry little Christmas. Now, this rayon seam binding, let me show you what I did. There was no way I was going to match this color exactly, so I came as close as I could. I just cut a length of the rayon seam binding, and I'm using a combination of cranberry, cherry pie, and espresso. The cranberry and the espresso are from the color wash line, and cherry pie is from the dilutions. I'm not worried about this being permanent. It's not going to get anywhere near water. So I'm just going to put some of both of these colors on here. I'm going to kind of scooch this around. Let me just grab some paper towel, pick the rest of this up, and then I'm going to come in. This is a little bright, so I'm going to come in and I'm going to tone this down with some espresso. Now, all of these colors are my watered down versions, so you need to bear that in mind when you're working. If you're working with the colors straight from the bottle, then you might need to rethink how much you're using, because it obviously will make a difference. Now, I just absorbed a lot of the color out of here, and I actually absorbed a lot of the espresso out, so I think I'm going to put some more of that back in there. I'm trying to tone this down and get this to look a little bit more earthy and aged, the way that this cover does. And I'm going to call this done. I'm actually going to dry this, and then I'm going to show you how I'm going to distress it a little bit further. So that I don't burn my fingers, I'm just going to hold this with some tweezers. It only takes a minute with a heat tool to get this to dry. And once it is dry, you can see that this color has changed a little bit. It does lighten up once it dries, and you can certainly see that it's very different from this, but I think I can get it a little bit closer. So what I'm going to do is pick one of the word bands. This one is Jingle Bells, Jingle All the Way. And I need some good scissors for this. I need some that I can cut with that I know are not going to get gaffed up. So to start with, I'm just going to cut one end, and I'm going to feed this through. And I'll trim this out again, but for now I want to get it in there. And I can see that this is pretty close to being long enough. There's going to be a little bit of waste here, but not a lot. So all I'm going to do is feed this back through like this and get this arranged the way that I like it. And this side actually looks pretty good. I don't think I want to do too much to that side other than I want to trim this again just because it got a little bit raggedy. Oops. And then figuring out how long I want this here, probably trim this something like this. And now what I'm going to do, eventually what I'll do is I'll pull this taut and fold this over, and I'll put just a little bit of glue back here, and that will keep this all in place. And you can see on the one that I've got done, it sort of keeps it folded and out of the way so that it doesn't pop out from any place else. And then once that's done, I can bring in, once again, I can bring in my walnut stain and my little cut and dry foam, and then I can just actually distress it this way just by adding some color like that. It darkens it. It makes it look a little bit more distressed. And I know I mentioned this a moment ago. That's basically what I did. This is the trading card from that paper, and these are all 12 by 12 papers, but certainly there are elements within them that you can use. You're not forced to use an entire piece. So once I get myself ready here, I'm basically at the point to being ready to start assembling. I'm going to grab some score tape and some other glues, and then I'll get myself set up and I'll show you how to put this all together. Assembling the items on the cover really begins with actually adhering this paper to the cover itself. So I've put some score tape on the back. Now this is kind of haphazard. My initial thought was to put score tape all around the border and then just put a strip down the middle. And then the more I thought about that, the more I thought that I really want to make certain that this paper is well adhered and there aren't any gaps. I don't want this to lift after the fact. So I ended up with this kind of mess, but basically I have score tape all over here. So I'm just going to remove the backing paper. Now with score tape, it's super sticky. It's a very, very effective way to adhere one thing to another, but you get one chance. So you need to make certain, and I'm going to pull this toward me because I want to kind of stand on my toes and peer down at it. And I want to make certain that my borders are about the same all the way around. Make certain that I'm square. Now if you want to be a little more precise than my eyeball method, of course you can do that. And here we go, this is already on here. Now, I want to think about, there's a little bit more pattern here in this paper, and they're not all like this. This one just happens to have this white distressing on it. So I'm kind of thinking about whether or not I want this to be the bottom or the top. I'm just going to arrange things on here and see how they look. And I think at the end of the day, it probably doesn't make all that much difference. Now, I do know that I want this here at the top, my little word band. I want these pieces here, and then I want, now I can move this a little bit into the frame a little bit better, and I know that I want this piece along the bottom. I don't exactly know how far, but I'm going to guess that that's pretty reasonable as I look at this. Now, I am a little bit long here, so I'm going to bring in my scissors, and I'm just going to trim this. I've got 1/8 inch score tape on the back. I think that's the next thing I'm going to do is get this piece on, because I know that this is going to vary very little from top to bottom in terms of how far away from this bottom edge I'm going to put it. So I do want to get that on there now, and it's done and out of the way. All I want to do is eyeball this and make certain that I'm straight. I also want to get my edges lined up. Okay, that looks pretty good. So it's in place too. Done the same thing here. I put a piece of score tape on the back, but I'm going to reserve this for a minute, and I'm actually going to reserve everything else. Now, my glue is not entirely dry. You can still see some blobs in places, but it's dry enough that I can handle this. And so attaching the tree to the cover, and mine is going to be off-center like this, attaching the tree to the cover is going to be done with a great deal of glue. I don't believe score tape will work. I think that it's not the best solution for this particular adhesive problem. It's not actually a problem, but you get my drift. So I'm going to go with my, this is my standby. When I use glue, this is basically what you see me use, and my toothpick method. So I'm just going to smear plenty of glue on here. Now the beauty of this is that it dries clear, so that's going to be a bonus. And as I said a while ago, I know that this part of the tree is probably not going to be stuck onto the card or onto the book cover itself. It's just the nature of the way this is going to lay there. So I'm probably not going to bother to put glue up there, but I am going to put ample amounts of glue along the back here. Now this is obviously going to take some time to dry. How long really depends on temperature and humidity, but I would give this at least a good 6 to 8 hours and possibly longer. If you live in a place where it's really humid, then it's obviously going to take longer. Now I came back after we talked about this tree previously. I came back and I trimmed the back of this some more so that the tips of these the bristles are more or less even with the back of this little round stump here. So I'm going to put some glue on here too. I want this in place. And I'm just going to put a narrow line along there. I think that's probably enough. So I'm going to just hold this by the trunk, and I'm going to place this where I want it to be. Now, because this glue is going to take some time to set up, I may have to come back at some point and readjust this. I want to make certain that my tree is turned properly so that my star is facing forward. I don't want it tilted and looking to one side or the other. But this actually looks pretty good. I don't think I'm going to fiddle with that. So I want to put this on. I want to lay my 25 in and my stars just to be certain that that tree is really where it needs to be. And I think that I'm reasonably satisfied with that. I don't think I need to move it up or down. I think that that's pretty well placed. So next thing I want to do is go ahead and get this word band in place. And again, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm just going to spread some glue on the back. I don't think that score tape is going to be effective for this either. So I'm doing my best not to make a mess. I'm going to lay this in place. And I'm really just eyeballing this in terms of center. I mean, if you wanted to measure and find the center point, you can do that, but I'm satisfied with doing it this way. Same thing with the numbers. I'm going to put a little bit of adhesive in here, a little bit of glue rather, in here. These are kind of hollow, so you have to get the glue along the edges too. This is a little bit picky, but at the end of the day it will work. This. Now I'm not going to push this into place. I just kind of want to lay it there. Paper towel for my fingers, because I want to get the five done, and then I want to put them in place and see if that looks right. So again, same kind of thing going on here. But honestly, this is probably the most difficult part of this entire project. None of this is hard. It's just preparation and assembly for the most part. What I don't want to do is drop this on here. That would really stink. All right, that actually looks pretty darn good. I might come in with another toothpick and just make some adjustments, but I don't think I want to do much with this. I think that they look fine the way they are, so I'm going to kind of press them in place and call them done. That might need just a smidge, but not much. All right, so now I've got my greeting cards, my trading stamps and my stars that have to be put in place. So let me drag the stars out here. And I believe there are four different sizes. So there's this big one, and there's that middle size one, then there's a smaller one still. I'm going to spread these out, and then an even tinier one. So let's see what we have here. I don't want this to be too busy, so maybe I'll slide my little cards down, and maybe I need to put the large star on this side since I have a little bit more room over here. I don't want this to be symmetrical. I like asymmetry, but I also don't want this to look crowded. Okay, so that actually looks reasonably good. I think what I'll do is go ahead and put the stars in place, one at a time. Oops. Again, just a little dab of glue on the back here. Drop that in place. Now I'm not going to do all of them. You don't need to see me do all of them. Once I have them all in place, then I'm just going to peel the backing paper off the score tape, make certain that my trading cards are turned the right way. And this time I'm going to use the stripe in the paper to visually align myself to make certain that I'm straight, and that looks pretty good. So it's in place too. At this point, this is basically done. I can put this to one side and let it dry. I will need to think about punching holes. Now to do that, I'm going to use this We Are Memory Keepers the Crop-A-Dial tool. This punches a 1/4-inch hole, which will work really well with these book rings. I believe that I'm going to use two. I think I'll probably line them up so that they're kind of in here someplace. It's just a question of making your marks, putting your punches in, and then you need to do that to both the front and the back cover. From here, what's left are pages, and I have a couple of different options for that. I think I'm going to use some 140-pound watercolor paper, and then I think I'm going to use some of the fabulous papers that are in that Merriment paper stash. They're really pretty, and I'm going to mix them with the watercolor paper. I think they'll make really nice pages for the book. Inspiration is a funny thing. I had already filmed an entirely different ending to this video. It would have looked much the same as what you see, because obviously the finished product is the same. But in the process of filming that, I was moving some things around and out popped one of these little chipboard stars. I finished filming, I thought I was done, and then I started to play because I wanted to finish putting everything together and actually assemble the book so I could take a photo. And I started to play with these stars. And I realized that if I painted them white and I glittered them with the clear rock candy glitter, the same thing I used on the Christmas tree, they would look kind of interesting. And then I remembered back in the summer when I attended the summer trade show, when this glitter was brand new, I remember Tim working with it, and actually he could come in and hit this with some distress ink to change the color. So you can age this if you want. So here are antique linen and walnut stain. And here's my piece that I had been working on, my piece of cut and dry foam. And I'm going to do what I saw Tim do, which is to just, and I'm going to start with the antique linen first, so it's a little bit lighter color. And this is actually pretty subtle, but I know that you'll be able to see it. I'm just ever so lightly touching this, and let me show you. Whoops, this is one of the ones that I haven't done anything to, and you can just see a little bit of the antiquing on here. This is the one that I've just put a little bit of color on, and I could put a little bit more on here. And all this does is take them from being white, and it just tones them down a little bit, which I think is really nice. I was really undecided about what I wanted to do with the back cover. I mean, I knew I was going to put some paper on here like this, and ultimately I did end up putting paper on the inside of both the front and the back covers, but beyond that I wasn't really sure. I thought I might print out Happy Holidays or Merry Christmas so that I could just print it on paper, maybe some watercolor paper, and then I could age it much like what I'm doing now with antique linen and or walnut stain to just tone that down a little bit. And out popped that star as I was filming. So I kind of took that as a little serendipitous nudge from my muse and decided to go for it. So now all I'm going to do, and let me tell you what I did. I used the quick dry adhesive again. I smeared it on top of the chipboard star with my finger, and then I just dumped the Clear Rock Candy Distress Glitter over the top. Let it dry, and they end up looking like they did just a moment ago before I came in with the antique linen and aged them a little bit. So now all I'm going to do is arrange them on the back cover. I'll glue them in place and the book is essentially done. So it'll be just a matter of taking the front cover. Here are all my pages, and you can see that I have picked up some paper from the Merrymint paper stash, and I'm going to use that along with these covers to create the finished book. I have some book rings. Get this lined up. I have some book rings. The other one is here. Here it is. So I'll just put these in place. And you know, this is fun. You can mount photos on here once you know the holidays are over and you get your photos printed. You can mount all kinds of ephemera from Christmas, whatever that ends up being, whether it's a special card you received. I don't need to tell you what ephemera is. You guys collect all that and you're well aware of what it is. But at the end of the day, you're left with this really nice book. Now, this would make a great gift. If your child has a favored teacher in school or one that you're particularly appreciative of, I'm certain that receiving something like this would be a very positive thing and that the person would certainly enjoy it. Whether you make these as gifts for your friends or whatever it ends up being that you decide to do, I think that they're a really nice project. I hope you get to make them too and that you make art and have fun.